What I knew used to break the signature.
My mother and dad come over the same time as David from Switzerland. With their roll-ups. Alright.
Fine.
Guten Nachmittag.
Guten Abend.
Good afternoon, everyone. And here we are here at the Vishuva, Turner Hall. And Dr. Heim is going to video this, and I'm going to try to have a little conversation with all of you about your history around the Maple Leaf Cheese Factory, and a little about growing up on the farm, and maybe we can interject a little going to school or whatever. But if you think while we're talking, something that's kind of a humorous event or maybe a catastrophe or anything of human interest, you know, bring it up, because we have a lot of people that milk cows, a lot of people that make cheese, but we need something that maybe adds a little flavor to our conversation, okay? And to my left here, I got Hans Schlappbach and Helen, his wife Helen. Her maiden name was Altalman, and of course that's her brother Charlie here, and his wife Ruth. And Ruth, your maiden name?
Geba.
And are you all Swiss?
No.
I'm
Welsh.
You're a Welsh. Oh, you're up in the Winter Point Welsh. Rui up in there.
That's right.
Yeah, Rui up in that area, right? Yeah, that's Welsh country up in there. Mining. And but then Charlie, your parents are from Switzerland, Swiss. And so I'm going to ask you then, what part of Switzerland was your family from?
Well, my mother came from near Bern, and my dad came from Thurgau.
Okay.
In Bishopshell. His parents were farmers.
Well, the reason we ask this, we're kind of saying, you know, there were a lot of farmers, you know, yeah. And of course other people brought their relatives over or whatever it is, and see that in my area group, we were all farmers, you know. And Hans, where were you from? What part did your folks come from?
Well, my folks would have been from Steffi, where he lives down by Steffi.
Okay, so we got a Thun, a Thurgau, and a Berner, and a Welsh, how do you like that?
Yeah. My mother was from Salt Lake County.
Yeah, that's it. By Berner.
Yeah. Well, there was an appointment. Don't you say an hour to walk to Bern?
All right, I'm going to start from left to right. Hans, you grew up on a farm?
Yeah.
And milked the cows by hand?
My mom worked.
Anything interesting you can tell me about the early farm days? Did you haul milk to a cheese factory?
We hauled milk to a cheese factory. And first I can remember, Dad hauled the milk with the milk rig and horses. Then we progressed to a truck. Things like that.
You don't remember the cheesemaker that was there at the time, or the name of the factory?
The factory up there. Fred Berger was the cheesemaker. He was a cousin of ours.
Oh, I see. We were trying to compile this together, so you know, kind of, so there's much information that we can get.
And then we hauled milk to another factory south of us, and Walter Miller was a cheese maker there.
About what year do you think that was? Give or take 4 or 5 years?
30s and 40s, 30s. Maybe.
And you all met with the horses?
Yeah.
Any runaways?
Not really.
No. What about the whey? Take the whey back in the cans?
We brought the whey back in the cans.
Or were you early enough for the barrels?
No, we brought it back in the cans.
Whose job was it to feed the pigs?
Well, you bring the milk home and then wash the cans out. Set them out to dry again.
All right, now how did you get down here to meet Helen here?
I worked for her uncle, and that's the way I met Helen. She came up there.
And her uncle did for Helen.
He was in a cheese factory in Pure White.
Oh, Pure White, okay.
Yeah. He was my dad's brother.
Otto,
and that's where I met him. And then I guess from there, Hans went into the service. And then after he got out of service, we started dating and ended up down in here. He worked in Monticello at Escher Brothers for about a year or 2 years before we were married. So that's, and then we sort of stayed down in the area.
And then what occupation were you in while you were when the two of you?
Well, we went to farming. And
well, you made cheese for a short time.
Yeah.
Down at Prairie Hill Factory where Grossen is now.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, well, it wasn't a year.
A year.
It was less than a year, a little less than a year.
What kind of cheese did you make?
Swiss cheese.
Swiss. But farming was really your...
Yeah.
Mama helped milk the cows, the chores, and how many children did you have there?
Well, we had actually 5 children. We have 3 living. And, yeah, they grew up on the farm. Our oldest son now, our oldest daughter passed away. So our oldest son was about 2 months old when we went to the farm. My folks owned the farm. And so after my father passed away, well, we went out there and rented it. And our milk went to the condensery for some time because that was where it was going at the time. And then we went grade A and our milk went to St. Louis. And actually, they didn't go to the Maple Leaf until
Kenneth took over.
And then now.
Kenneth's our son.
And then from the other farm that my folks had, they rented it out. And then when the younger son went farming there, I believe that their milk went to the Maple Leaf from there before our son went on the farm.
Where did you go to school? And you were born where?
At the Maple Leaf Cheese
Factory.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I was born and raised there. And well, I wasn't born there, I guess. But
your father was making cheese.
My father was making cheese there. And then when I got old enough to go to school, I went to Smiley School, which is it is no longer a school, but our land joins up with the Smiley School.
Did you have to walk by the waves in the wintertime and everything?
Yeah, it was, what was that, a mile, I think.
Yeah.
And we usually walked, and every once in a while we'd get a ride with someone. In those days you could ride with someone you'd know, and they'd stop and pick you up and give you a ride home. So today would be another story.
How many was in the school?
Oh, what did we have?
It varied, but I think my class was 8, which was a big class. I think probably about 28 was the biggest it ever was.
Yeah, I only had 2 in my class myself.
And all 8 grades. And
yeah.
Any stories you can tell me that the school teacher, she didn't marry a cheesemaker, someone said they used to stay with the cheese factory. One time I read an article where they said the school teachers, well, get yourself a cheese maker, the hired man, and you got a good vocation and it makes good. I heard it through the grapevine, I don't know. All right, so you were born on the cheese factory then, and I don't imagine what kind of cheese did your father make?
My father made wheel Swiss all the time. And a lot of times he didn't have a hired man, and he'd have to go wash all those cheese himself. And I guess in later years he did have a hired man. And there was one thing I do remember that sort of struck me funny. It does today anyway. My dad was very upset, but he was dipping the cheese out of the kettle, you know.
Sure.
And of course, the hired man always held on to the legs. Well, this hired man let him go that one day, and into the kettle he went head first. You know?
That's the Prairie Hill, too, I guess.
Yeah, my father was very upset.
That I got, too. There was a lot of baptism. I didn't realize them. The first time I heard it was only one, but I heard about several since then.
Then another incident I remember, this one was really a bad one. Well, I think it was early in the morning, or sometime during the day. Up here, there was a skunk in the making room. And, oh my gosh, what do we do? You know, here's a skunk. if we don't watch it, he's going to go over everything and it'll ruin everything, you know. And well, anyway, they had some help there, and I don't think Charlie was there. Were you there helping?
Yeah.
Well, anyway, finally this skunk went out in the boiler room, and this little door down below was open, and that skunk went in there, and by then it closed the door, and oh, man, what an odor.
Yeah, well, I had the odor when it come time to clean that skunk out, too.
But it was bad.
It was worse back then, but it was terrible.
It was terrible, but anyway, we were fortunate he didn't let anything go while he was running around in our making room.
Well, you know, there were a lot of animals around, more so than there are today. Yeah. Let me ask you this. I suppose, you know, like making Swiss, there wasn't too much work that you could do, really.
No.
Did you have chickens or on the back table?
Yes, my folks always had chickens, if you will.
You have to get the eggs in?
Yeah, I did until we had a mean ornery rooster. And then I told my dad that that rooster was chasing me, you know, and I was afraid of him. He said, oh, that rooster won't hurt you. And he went out there, the rooster went after him. That was the end of the rooster. Oh, but yes, I did go out and gather eggs, but that rooster did me in that day.
Now, did you make soup out of him?
Yeah, I think so. We did something with him.
Did you have any old clucks pick your hand or anything?
Oh, yeah, but I never minded that. I always carried chickens around. I think I have pictures of me carrying chickens around. I love chickens. But that rooster was something else.
So then you ended up farming, so you've kind of more or less been around Maple Leaf all your life there.
Right, and the milk from the farm all goes to Maple Leaf Factory in Twin Grove now.
That's after they moved.
Right. Yeah. Well, I was going there with the Maple Leaf Catch, you know, in Albany too.
All right, so your father bought a farm, but then the milk went to Grade A, you say, and it went to the condensery for a while.
Yeah.
It's kind of an odd thing with old cheesemaker going the other way. I don't like to bring it up, but
yeah.
I know how it goes, you know. It,
well, I guess they had been there for so many years going to the condensery, and it just stayed that way, and it was that way when we moved there, and I don't know, but it did from the other farm, the first farm that my father bought, that milk went to the Maple Leaf.
But as far as the cheese making, there wasn't much a girl could do there, much to with them and toddler.
No, no.
I tell you, it's funny.
Okay.
Now, Charlie, it wasn't funny, it was tragic. She must have been about two. And there was a bucket of starter, boiling hot starter, sitting on the floor. And she backed into it and sat in it.
Yeah.
Talk about a kid screaming. She wasn't any more than two. You don't remember it all.
No,
oh, she was burned.
Oh, my God, you know, because that's around 100 degrees.
Yeah, it was hot. And she backed into it.
To make the culture. They would control the culture with the heat.
Yeah. Well, it was sterilized in a certain place.
All right, Charlie, you grew up in the factory there. What was your chores, or what do you remember about the fact that farmers coming in
One of the first things I can recall right offhand was I had to haul wood in every night. Even in the summertime, in order to ripen the cheese and heating them, mm-hmm. Dad would build a fire, you know, round oak stove in there.
I see.
And so I had to haul wood, and then I had to haul coal in. In later years.
Did you have to clean the boiler?
Sometimes, yeah. I had to do that.
The flues.
Yeah. That had, somebody had to do it every day. Another thing that came to my mind, Dad used to make some brick and some blocks with it one time. In the wintertime, there wasn't enough milk to make anything else. I remember blocks, had this picture in here somewhere. I'm sure it's brick here on the shelves. I can't remember that, but I remember he made block once in a while.
And that's where they put a little smear on the brick.
Yeah.
It's the shelf curate, they call it.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
Really a number
here. No, it wasn't that strong.
But they usually kind of like Limpkey's brick in that, but it was shelf curate, whereas today the brick was made and putting in the wrapper and what you put in from your culture, your starter. Well, what other chores can you tell me about the factory?
I got a little older and I had to watch the thermometers on the kettle to make sure the milk didn't get scorched. I forget one. Well, I can remember Martin when we had a steam. I remember the old fire wagons that went underneath the kettles. I think there were two or maybe three kettles there. They run the fire wagon from one to another to heat it. That was, I wasn't old enough to do anything with
it. Was that on a track or?
Yeah, it was on a track.
It was on a track.
On a track underneath the kettles, and there was a grate over part of it where they pull it off and put, build the fire up in it, and then they'd walk over to get down to the milk intake. And well,
that's going back,
but well, there's some old pictures in here too. I brought it back to my mind. I had kind of forgotten about some of that stuff, but
I'll take it over here to Dennis Dalton here, and he's going to dock here as he and take some off. I'm glad you brought it very much. Yeah. This is what we need.
Well,
in the center
I thought you got the pictures. Where is this thing? We looked a bit last night to find it, but we found it.
I was talking to Helen. She said, "I know with Charlene, of course. I know Hans and Helen here from Tri-State Tourism. And Hans that always calls them Dairy Queens around with his convertible there, you know. And my God, it looks like he's enjoying every minute of it.
Right.
You know,
I think he does.
When I was 16, my dad was laid up with a bad back. I mean, he was really in a bad way. The hired man quit. The only one they made to wash the cheese. So I had to do it.
And what age were you in that?
16.
Sixteen.
I weighed about 200 pounds and I didn't have any trouble at all. Moving those 200 pounds. I couldn't move 50 pounds cheese today, but at 16 I was able to. And,
how many cheese were they making then about that time?
Well, it varied, of course. In the wintertime it went down to about two or three, maybe four. Summertime it would get up to seven.
So it kept all winter then.
Dad built that up. See, they remodeled everything when they put the, built the boiler room. They built the boiler room, they put in a steam engine for power. Before that, it had been an old Fuller and Johnson engine sitting over in the corner to turn all the
pulleys
for the pump and for the wave pumps, the separator, the kettles. So all done with the.
It was winter. You had to kind of like a line shaft.
Right? Yeah, right.
Line shaft. Bells coming down with all these different motors, and the line shaft was up above in the back room, or box room, as we used to call it. That's going right back there, right?
Yeah, I know there was a big tank up in the corner. The milk went from the intake, went down into another tank below that, and this pump sucked the milk out of that, pushed it up into this tank up above. And then that milk was fed out, metered out of there to the kettles. And I know we used to, that's another story, I had to wash it to get the right amount of milk, skimmed milk, we skimmed some to get the standardized. And we had a certain point in the kettle where that milk had to come to, and then I had to run the spouts together again, run the whole milk through.
And of course, to do that was because if you had too high a fat in the Swiss cheese, you got that glass. They always like a full cream cheese, but and then later on, it became important because they wanted to slice it. Mm-hmm. You know, it makes a better eating cheese, but you always have trouble with the gloss. The gloss,
mashed. Yeah. Well, that was more from the poor milk.
Strabble.
Poor milk than anything else.
Okay, so then you washed the cheese, seven cheese, that was quite a bit. And did you abort the hired man then, or?
Well, most of the years, although the last few years, we didn't anymore. There was a one hired man came and he had a kind of a shack and moved it on the neighbor's land down the road and lived in that. And later, Dad had a I don't know how big it was, two or three room house built on skids, set on posts for a hired man. So then for a while there were two houses down there, shacks. I couldn't say I guess. But the little house that Dad built was a real nice, cute little house.
How long was your father there on the factory then?
20 years.
20 years.
He went there in 22, single. And then my mother came over in 23.
Did you know her from over there, you think? Or?
Yeah, he did. That's another story. Not too long after he got here, he had a bad accident. Somebody crawled him off the road and caught his leg on a bridge abutment. And he came to his foot, I think it was his right leg, was up in his armpit, his foot was in his armpit. And so it was really badly shattered. Anyway, he was, somebody picked him up and took him to the hospital in Monroe. And he laid there for several days because he was penniless at the time. Finally, a doctor from Freeport said, I'll take a chance on him. I want to try something anyhow. This was when traction was first coming in. So he spent quite a bit of time in traction to get that leg strength lengthened out back to where it was supposed to be. And it was successful. Anyway, while my dad was laid up, he quit writing to Mom. They were engaged before he left, but he quit writing because I'm not going to let her come over here to a cripple. So then after he got on his feet again, and he started writing again. And she came over a year later. They got married. He got here the, well, she got to New York the 4th of July. She must have gotten to Monroe here about the, well, I don't know. They got married the 12th, so it would be 5 days after she got here, they were married. And a year later, I came along.
Was that right? And how many children did they have, Helen?
Just the two of us.
Just the two of us.
Yeah, just the two of us. Yeah, my mother, well, they, where they met in Switzerland, my father was going to school at the Riti, which was a cheesemaking school. And that Riti is located at Solikoven, where my mother lived. And that's where they actually met, is through there. And,
well, then,
anyway.
Then on your chores, like if your father was here, then, like you said, you had the thermometers and you ended up washing cheese, and did you ever have to haul milk or anything? Or?
Ever haul milk? The patrons all hauled their own milk. Dad never hauled any milk. He said he wasn't going to start, and he never did. Of course, he probably could have picked up more milk, but didn't really need any more milk because that was all the building would hold.
Seven cheese, that's a
good side operation back then.
Factory. So they were mostly with pickups then?
Yeah, pickups and wagons. Homemade pickups. I know there were three or four of them had old cut down Buicks they made into trucks. And, one or two had coupes that they put a little box in the back big enough to haul their milk. One guy used to haul his milk on a running board.
Well, they didn't get it there.
He got it there, you bet.
Well, how did you get it up to the intake there?
Well, it was a, well, we had a hoist there for the 30-gallon can. Had a lot of 30-gallon milk coming 30-gallon cans. They had a hoist there and crank it up and dump it into the receiving can.
You remember building any tubs? We were talking about tubs today or the early part. Or
I was around. I never did it. Mm-hmm. Used to go around, hang around, watching my dad do it. He made all the tubs for the cheese that went out. I don't know when that was, but sooner, eventually, one time they hauled it on trucks, the tubs. Then they started bringing the skids out on the trucks. So they put the milk, the cheese on the skids and hauled them in. Sometimes, early days, it was open trucks, and then later it was a cover truck, cover built truck that they came and got it in.
You ever remember going out and seeing some of the farmers there, cooling the milk or anything?
Oh, yeah. After those days, there was no such thing as a field man. A cheese maker was his own field man. When somebody was having trouble, why, he had to go out and see him. And the biggest trouble was usually the cows drank the milk, the stock tank dry the night before, so it wasn't cool. That was often the trouble. And I remember Dad carried a rod with him when they had milk machines, and he'd run the rod through the hose. We come up full of crud. Well, here's the problem. You got to clean this stuff up.
Is that never heard of a rod going through it?
Oh, yeah. It was a rod. It was about, I suppose, about that long. You pull that, push it in from one end, pull it out the other, and if it come out that much junk on it, you know, it was garbage.
You wouldn't think the doc is smiling over here, but you wouldn't think that affect the milk, but it was just the air. But it somehow it affected it.
Well, it was bacteria.
You know, after it went through the pulsators and whatever, so on and so forth. Oh, that was part of the job of the cheese maker, and to keep the farmer happy and still be able to help him or criticize him, maybe you might say, or put him in the fold.
It was the funniest was one time that I didn't see, but heard my dad talk about it. Some farmers had springs to cool their milk, so they had real nice cold milk. And they just told them always to crack the lids a little bit at night. so the air wouldn't milk wouldn't suffocate. One morning, a frog came out of the can. one of these spring cool milk.
Well, I guess it was better than that stuff in the other type.
Oh, yeah, much better.
Yeah, much better than clean frogs. They used to say sometimes, you know, there's a difference between dirty milk and contaminated milk. Mm-hmm. Put it that way. You got clean hay or clean chaff, or the chaff comes down from up above the hay mow and so on and so forth, or even clean dirt. But if it's got it off bacteria off the manure or what it is, mm-hmm. it's contaminated. Anything else? I noticed on the one in the hay barrel there, it says that the hay barrel there, I noticed some lovely pictures.
Wait, Hank, yeah. Well, that went in about I'm not sure what year that went up either. I was old enough to remember it happening, but when I got older, I know almost every morning, it seemed like, I had to go up and clean that tank out when the last patron was there for his way. Because all he usually got was washings anyway, so he it wouldn't quite go around always.
Never. It seemed like
it. This thing was, the tank must have been 12 feet high, sitting up on a ladder, 8 foot still. Yeah, we had a ladder go up the outside, and had a ladder to get down on the inside. And then it get about so far and clean out some of the stuff, and I think I had to wrap on the pipe and somebody started running water. We never had a pressure system either, come to think about it either. We had a pump. It was a force pump. Pumped the water upstairs. And the water that we used in the factory and in our house too was a different tank, but it came by gravity.
Is that right?
It came down by gravity.
Oh, there must have been quite a tank up in there.
Well, of course,
we had one too, I remember now.
It was a 500 gallon tank, I suppose.
Yeah, used for cleaning, I remember now. It was a squirrel, a pet squirrel on the ground.
That
was
very nice.
No, that's right, I forgot about that. Well, it was nice that I. Now that you mentioned, first time I mentioned somebody cleaning the weight tank, that white stuff and all that.
Well, 2 or 3 days,
got all that really got us. Yeah.
Well, the guys that got that last, they were really pleased to get that because it was pretty good feed.
That's what they said,
And of course, also another viewer I had was when I got a little older now, big enough, seemed like it was often washing the separator. That was quite a chore. Because all between the
discs,
there was always a bunch of junk between them. And we'd take them apart and shake that stuff out, put it into a bucket, and the bottom of the great big ring, that ended up at the chicken house, all of that did. That was our chickens got their protein from that.
And then, of course, outside there, when they came with the horses there, the horse apples there, they did.
I can't remember much about that. Mom always had a beautiful garden. She supplied the whole neighborhood with fresh vegetables all summer every year.
Right.
It was all spaded by hand. I think one time they had it plowed and it was so terrible. After that, it spaded it. I imagine you'd have to come out and help spade it too, and I spaded it, and then we had the whole one.
Did you have to help?
Did you help?
Yeah, I think so. It was a big garden.
It was a big garden. I was
very big.
Twice as wide as this room and about 6-7 times as long. It was big. It was a big garden. We had a lot of food up.
Well, Ruth, how did you happen to get a hold of this Charlie here?
Well, I was in high school with Bob and came out there to college at that time. Kid 13 now.
Were you living on the cheese factory at that time yet, or were you farming?
I was off the farm. In fact, both of us left the farm, but the tea factory by then. My dad quit in 1942 in the spring. And then that summer, I worked for my uncle at Paola and at the cheese factory. And then I left to go to school. So I had said, I'm through with the cheese business. I never wanted to see it again. But I did go back again later for a short time.
Where?
Well, I went to work in Darlington for one summer.
The Buster there?
Yeah. He and I didn't quite see eye to eye. I told her the 4th of July I was leaving, and he says, you can go right now.
All right, so then you met Ruth here, and you grew up on a farm, and milk cows by hand?
Yeah.
Went to country school?
That's right, yeah.
Anything to add to this here, we're just about running out of tape. And how many children did you have?
We have six.
Six. Is anybody still farming?
No, oh, I'm sorry, our daughter, so. They, no, we're up to the cows.
Well, you've seen a lot of changes in your life here between the four of you, and I'm gonna look forward to seeing you again at one of the tri-state meetings. I don't know if you're going to Rock Island tomorrow or not.
If we can get out of bed earlier.
Yeah, that's a great way, it's a great way. I wanna thank you for adding, bringing up the old weight tank and the whole milk holes. You always bring back memories for myself, and thanks again, all of you for coming. And I don't know if we got time, just you read these farmers.
Okay, here.
Again, over here, that's all right.
Okay, well, Walter Wood is one of the old standbys. I know he must have been one member of the board of directors from the beginning. William Towns and his son Ivan, they had three farms that they hauled milk from. And then Burr Bagley, Kobe Broughton, William Peterson, and then he was followed by Fred Schneeberger on the same farm. And there was Frank Stevenson and his son Forrest. There's Andrew Oliver, Albert Summerfield, Ralph Truax, I'm not sure, I think he hauled milk there for a while. Frank Selden, William Baumgartner, John Roof, and a man named Sweetland, I can't remember his name at all, his first name, I remember his son's name, his name was Dwayne. His name was Marion Lobby, John Gruber, Frank Shereen, and he was followed by Lee Sanderman, Kenneth Klausner, and Bill Zolke, and then Fred Hefty and Fred Schmidt. Yeah, they're both Schmidt.
Let's see, we got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23. That's a good size. Good-sized factory.
Yeah, they wasn't always that big.
I don't want to start with five or six farms. Well, thanks again for coming. And Ruth and Kelly, bought them up by the college and whatever it is, and six children. I know that's a nice size.
Six children, 18 grandchildren,
19. Right. 18, yeah. And 80 cows, one daughter, and son-in-law. And Helen. It's for you and Hans to come. You can take care of those queens this summer and haul them around, okay?
As long as I can use your car, but I'm all right.
Okay, so I'll say Swiss again. Adiamitmanon, Bergora, and we'll see. I don't know if that Welsh can understand that or not.
Oh, she can understand more than you
think. Adios.
She can't repeat it, but she can understand it.
See you.
All right, I'll come. Be along. There we go.